This week in Virology, the podcast about viruses, the kind that make you sick. This week in Virology, episode number 305, recorded on October 3rd, 2014. Hey, everybody, I'm Vincent Racaniello. And you are listening to TWiV, the podcast all about viruses. Joining me today from Western Massachusetts, Alan Dove.
Good to be here.
How's it going out there in the West?
It's going okay. It's a gorgeous day today. It was raining all yesterday and through the night. It's supposed to be raining tomorrow and through that night. But today we had a nice little glimmer of clear blue skies, some low-level scattered clouds this morning, but very, very pretty. 68 Fahrenheit, 20 Celsius.
Also joining us from southeastern Michigan, Kathy Spindler.
Hi, everybody.
How's it out there?
We currently have gray skies. We've had some rain. We're going to have more. Temperature, 64 degrees. It's the wrong device. I can't translate it easily. Must be about 17, because 61 is 16. So,
right. I was in Brazil this week, as you guys know, and it was really warm there because they're just starting summer. And I've got in this morning, but here it's quite nice. It's 21 Celsius, sunny, 54 degrees. And I have to show you, I'm looking at the weather on...
Yes. Oh, I have that app.
It's an iPhone 6.
Is that the 6 or the 6 Plus?
No, it's the 6. 6 Plus is too big.
Yeah, somebody posted a graphic I saw on Twitter that compared the sizes of the various iPhones to a Pop-Tart.
Yeah. Let's see if I can... So here's a pen. Let me get these together. So it's about the length of a pen, right?
Wow.
Okay.
Now, and, of course, I had made for it a new cover.
Excellent.
To fit it, right? It worked out pretty well.
Yeah.
I actually like it. It's quite thin. Mm-hmm. And the cover makes it a little thicker. But it's pretty cool. And the neat thing is, I hardly have any icons. And now these used to fill the screen of my 4S. Now you can see there's a couple of extra rows, so it's pretty big.
It's cool.
Toys. Got to have them. This episode of TWiV is brought to you by the Department of Microbiology at the Icon School of Medicine at Mount Sinai, composed of over 20 virology labs, all centralized in one building in the heart of the Big Apple. That's New York City. This department is a perfect fit for anyone with an interest in pursuing virus research. The department is presently looking to recruit prospective graduate students to apply to their program. They have a December 1st deadline. You can apply online at mssm.edu/mic. And if you're a postdoc or you want to be one, contact the faculty that you're interested in. Go to their website. Same URL. Check it out. Great program. As you know, I was there. I got my PhD there. Peter Palazzi's there. Adolfo Garcia Sastre, Ben Tenhoover, and many others.
Have I shown this particular artifact that I have on TWiV before? I don't know if you can. can you read? Am I coming up on the camera here?
Come closer.
Here we go. I think you can switch to...
Oh, it's a little out of focus now because maybe it's too close.
Maybe,
I don't know.
Maybe back about here?
Just tell us what it reads.
Yeah, I can see it.
Property of Mount Sinai Hospital, NYC.
Oh.
So I took that from Mount Sinai when I was a student, and I was using it in my office at Columbia, and I guess you pinched it or something.
I seem to have ended up with it somehow, yes.
It was probably at the lab. I probably had a couple of them, yeah. It's pretty funny.
Yeah, so I appreciate their sponsorship of our show and their sponsorship of my document management all these years.
I probably don't use it anymore, right?
Oh, I occasionally. Every now and then I'll have something to staple.
Hmm. So, Alan, you went to grad school in New York City. Is that a good place to do that?
It is, yeah. I knew some folks at Mount Sinai, and it's in a nice part of town, actually in a nicer part of town than Columbia.
Did you meet your current wife at a meeting at Mount Sinai?
I did, yes. It was a viral pathogenesis meeting at Mount Sinai where Laura and I met. So, move to New York, fall in love, go to Mount Sinai. It worked out great for me.
Certainly did. All right, if you're an early career scientist and you're interested in public outreach and you want to share your love of microbiology with the world, apply to the American Society for Microbiology's Headquarter Communications Fellow. It is a six-month fellowship in Washington, D.C. That's where their headquarters are, and perfect opportunity to learn more about the world of science communication. They're accepting applications through October 22nd. The online app is at bit.ly/communicationfellow. It's all one word. So that's the American Society for Microbiology, who helps us with TWiV. And their headquarters is where we did TWiV 300. It's a cool place to work, right?
It looked like a neat place to work.
Yeah. All right. Now, today, we're going to talk about
plant viruses.
We did that this morning in Journal Club. It was so much fun. It was really good.
Which plant virus did you talk about?
Oh, it had a really long name, and the acronym was also long. It ended in something like SBV, but there were three letters before that. Don't recall.
Plant viruses often have really funky names.
Oh, yeah. Something rice black, so it had B and R. Yeah. Anyway, it's good.
Actually, we're not going to talk about plant viruses because we got a lot of follow-up about our last episode, which was about Ebola virus, and things have been happening that we need to talk about.
Yeah.
So we are changing the name of this podcast to This Week in Ebola Virus until further notice. just kidding. We have here at TWiV, we have a sense of humor.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
All right. The first, this is for Kathy. Why don't you read this one, Kathy?
Sure. Taylor writes, Taylor was one of the students in our virology class last spring. Hi, Dr. Spindler. I was hoping you might be able to clear up a few things that have been bothering me lately. In keeping up with the Ebola outbreak, I've been considering the nature of negative strand RNA viruses. Is this a particularly nasty group, or is my judgment biased in light of the current epidemic? As a quick aside, why isn't it sufficient to target viral RDRPs? Is it a matter of drug delivery? I've been wondering about the evolutionary relationship between this group with their hosts, and given the nature of the necessary transcriptional machinery, it seems quite unique. Do you think that viruses share a common ancestor? If so, would it be nonsensical to assume the ancestor to be negative sense RNA viruses in light of the RNA world hypothesis? Thanks for your time and consideration. So I wrote back to her, but I asked if it was okay if we could talk about it on TWiV because I thought it was a good set of general questions. And with respect to the negative sense RNA viruses, it does seem like they comprise a lot of the nastiest ones. If you think of the filoviruses, the arenaviruses, rabies, influenza, the bunyas. But that being said, there's some plus strand RNA viruses and some DNA viruses that I wouldn't want to get either. But so I don't know. What do you think?
Well, you know, so this sort of came up before. I've mentioned in my mind should be a plus strand RNA virus because you're naked in the capsid, you get in the cell, and the cell just copies your makes protein. You don't have to have an RNA polymerase in the virion. It seems easy, but all viruses are not plus strand RNA viruses. Especially with Ebola, Marburg. Lassa, a lot of negative strand viruses are pathogens, but I think that we haven't cataloged all the viruses out there, so I think it's a bit premature there. But I think it's an interesting question. Would it be the ancestor? So my view of the ancestor of all viruses, in fact, of all life, is I think there were RNA molecules replicating in cell-free solutions. Ages ago, there were probably there was no protein coding stuff yet. They just could replicate, and so maybe they were negative strand in a sense because they didn't encode anything. And then I don't know how they got to be cells. It's really a tough jump, but so not coding for anything might have been. Now, of course, negative sense means the complement of the coding strand, so I'm not even sure that that's correct. I do think that RNA is the ancestor to everything.
That's an interesting point about how would you know negative sense in the RNA world, since it's defined in terms of protein coding.
So here's a kind of example. Viroids are small RNAs that infect plants and they cause disease. They don't encode any protein. So, you know, they're not plus, they're not minus. But yet the people in the field call the viroid plus strand and its complement the minus strand when they talk about replication, because it's actually replicated by cellular DNA-dependent RNA polymerase. So
yeah. I guess the plus strand is whatever does what you think of as the most interesting thing.
It could be. Could be, right?
And what about the question about targeting viral RDRPs?
Well, you can. I mean, reverse transcriptase is targeted, of course, very effectively by a variety of drugs, both nucleoside analogs and non-nucleoside analogs that bind right. The polymerase. So you could easily develop, and people have at companies discovered compounds that inhibit RNA polymerases. The problem is the mutation rate is so high, just like for HIV, that you get resistance very quickly. So you really need multiple drugs together. So the some of the new inhibitors of hepatitis C virus are RNA polymerase inhibitors, right? And they're being used in combination with interferon and ribavirin. And as new inhibitors come up, protease inhibitors, they will be used in combination. So it's fine to target it. It's not a problem with drug delivery. It's just a matter of monotherapy is not going to be useful for very long.
Right.
Is that basically what you told her?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Alan, can you take the next one?
Sure. Adam writes, "Hello, Twivsters. Last week you discussed a study that found that 2% of sampled dogs in France were seropositive for anti-Ebola virus antibodies. Like you mentioned on the show, this is almost certainly cross-reactivity. What you might not know, however, is that there may well be filoviruses in Europe, just not Ebola viruses. Loviu virus, I love you virus, LLOV, was discovered in 2002 in dead insect-eating bats in Spain, Portugal, and most importantly for us, France. Though it has not yet been isolated, the genome has been sequenced with the exception of the 3' and 5' untranslated regions, and it's been proposed for inclusion in the family Filoviridae in the genus Quavovirus. It's not conclusively known to cause disease in bats or humans, though there's some weak evidence suggesting pathology in bats. Interestingly, humans frequently visit the caves in which the dead bats have been found without any known cases of the disease. It may well be that the seropositive dogs were exposed to LLOV, and the antibody used for the study cross-reacts with LLOV to some extent. I've included a link to a relevant paper in PLOS Pathogens, which, of course, is open access, like everything should be." Adam sends this link.
So, Alan, if we were talking about this paper, the name of the episode would be I Love You, right?
Yes, I Yovi virus.
Yeah. I'm sure it's not pronounced that way.
No, it's...
I think we might have done this in an old TWiV. This is partially from Ian Lipkin, the discovery of this filovirus-like. What were you going to say, Kathy?
Just going to say that the genus name, Cueva, is the Spanish for cave, I believe, because it's the virus was found in Loviu Cueva, or Cueva Loviu, whatever. Yeah.
So this was found in bats. These bats had been dying off, so they went in and got some carcasses, and they isolated this from them. They also, they did PCR, of course. They didn't get infectious virus, and they also could find viral RNA in individual organs. There seemed to be pathology in the organs in the bat, suggesting that this might have been responsible for their death. But to date, nobody has a virus replicating.
Now, and people have also found filoviruses in insects, right? There was something with leafhoppers a number of years ago.
I don't know about that.
Yeah, I just pulled up the paper on PubMed. Filovirus-like particles detected in leafhopper. This is just detecting particles by electron microscopy, I believe. So that's not very definitive. Never mind.
Well, but they're
but if they're in insects, I would expect them to be in bats. That's the whole way to get that across.
So I guess it could be that the dogs got exposed to that virus, etc. Yeah.
Yeah. Or just cross reactivity with something completely innocuous.
Yeah. So this phylogenetically, this is ancestral to that, and the current Ebola viruses have a common ancestor. Anyway, it's pretty cool. Thanks for reminding us of that.
Thank you.
Next letters from Alan. It's not from you, right, Alan?
No, this is definitely not me.
Hello, TWiV.
Spelled the same.
Yes, he spelled correctly. Thank you, Alan.
Hello, TWiV doctors. I listen to many podcasts, but never miss a TWiV. Thank you for your excellent work. That's another good title. I never miss a TWiV, because everyone says that. A lot of people do, right? I do have a couple of questions. Up till now, you've answered them all. Estimating CFR, case fatality ratio. Please use something other than naive CFR when characterizing the threat of Ebola infection. So let me pause. Case fatality ratio, of course, is the number of deaths divided by the total number of diagnosed infections. So for you know, H5N1, the WHO has a set of criteria that say you have H5N1 infection, so that would be the denominator. The numerator is how many people die. So people get sick, they come to hospital, they get diagnosed. If they die, they're in the numerator. So that's the naive CFR, because sometimes you don't always know the number of deaths. You may know the number of sick people, right? But if they haven't died yet, then you don't know that.
And you may not know the number of sick people, because people can get sick and not show up at the hospital.
Yeah, that's a problem also, right? Of course, the real cool number is the fatality rate or ratio, which would be the number of deaths over the total number of infections.
Right.
And that's really hard to get, right? The total number of infections. To do that, you need serology surveys of people who aren't sick, right? Which maybe when this epidemic in West Africa is over, maybe we'll have that. That would be really interesting. So anyway, Alan continues, maybe we need a new number based on the facts. Since we do know the number of deaths and the number of recoveries, but not the outcomes for current patients, why not use those two numbers alone, i.e. deaths over deaths plus recoveries, he'd like to call the estimated mortality rate. This number would be a new patient's true risk as opposed to naive CFR, which is misleading at best during an exponential outbreak. When discussing with prognosis with patients, should the doctor use CFR or EMR? And he linked to a nice Lancet article which talks about this. It's case fatality rate for Ebola virus disease in West Africa. It's quite a short article which says basically that, you know, the current CFR is around 50% depending on how you do it. And the authors of this article say that it's probably higher because of this complication with the underestimation.
Right, because you're getting more and more infections. Since it's a growing outbreak, you're getting more and more infections, and those people haven't had a chance to recover or die yet.
But, well, let me finish reading, and then I'll tell you what I think. However, I don't see the utility of trying to estimate future CFR by using average time lag between infection or admission and outcome. Just use the known numbers. In Ebola's case, it's only 7.5 days away. And so some of the calculations can estimate the future by saying, you know, there's going to be this much time between when you get sick and when you die or don't die. I do see the usefulness of knowing the EMR for hospitalized patients versus untreated cases outside the fence. For instance, when deciding whether to pay for a taxi ride to the other hospital across town when turned away from this one versus just walking back home, uninfected members of the community might be interested in their odds of contracting Ebola from taking the same taxi to go shopping, etc. And he gives a link for a story. It says that people are getting Ebola infection by taxi.
And that's not a peer-reviewed story.
It's an independent. Just hearsay, actually.
Yes.
Meanwhile, CNN will continue to use the, quote, up to 90%, unquote, number for the ratings bump. So here's my thing. First of all, 40% or 90%, either way, that's pretty high.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure a physician would make any decision if it were one or the other, right?
No, if you've got something that's got a 40% case fatality rate and you've come to the hospital, they're going to treat you as if you're about to keel over.
Yeah, so I don't see the practical therapeutic value. I mean, this is great for having an overview of the outbreak, right? But, see, the thing is, the CFR, in this case, we've learned this, is totally based on therapy. I think we're going to learn this. We don't have enough numbers yet. But, you know, everybody that's come to the U.S. so far for treatment has survived. I think if you treat people properly, and many others have said this as well, you're going to survive.
And so it's not, you say treat people properly, it doesn't necessarily have to involve a lot of these experimental compounds. It's just supportive care, keeping the person hydrated, seems to make a big difference.
Right.
That's right. Yeah, it's not just an experimental drug, right? So I'm personally really, this is a revelation for me that it's not just the ultimate virulence of the virus, but it's how you treat the patients. I can imagine a situation where the case fatality rate would be less than 10%. So I don't know that this has a practical value.
Yeah.
No. Right.
All right. He continues another topic. Amplification versus attenuation. What would cause amplification versus attenuation of virulence and morbidity for a rapidly mutating virus such as Ebola? Now, listen to TWiV, so I understand that viruses tend to reach a truce with their hosts by becoming less lethal but often more virulent. On the other hand, I'm aware of laboratory studies that pass infections through multiple generations of hosts to amplify the infectious agent's ability to infect enormously. Ebola already seems able to infect with just one or two infectious particles, so where does it go from here? So virulence and lethality is really, they're both part of the same measure, both part of the pathogenesis of the virus. So I don't know what you mean by less lethal or more virulent. Less lethal, less killing less, but replicating more, maybe? Is that what you think he's talking about?
Yeah, I'm not sure. That puzzled me a little too.
Yeah, I'm not sure what we said that led him to conclude that that's what we meant. But I think the prevailing view in virology and other infectious disease fields is that you don't necessarily get a truce with the host. It depends on what's in the best interests of the pathogen. So you can have things that evolve to the point of, you know, like tapeworms or CMV, you know, where it ends up being a benign infection in most cases, and that happens to be the best way for those pathogens to spread.
Mm-hmm.
And you look at something like yellow fever virus, which has a very high fatality rate, and it doesn't seem to be bothered by the fact that it often kills its hosts, probably because it drives the host's fever way up and incapacitates them, which makes them more likely to be bitten by mosquitoes, which makes the virus more likely to spread. So it doesn't matter if you're yellow fever virus, you don't need to have your host up and around and walking or even surviving for very long. You just need them to preferably be bitten by a lot of mosquitoes. Whereas if you're CMV, you'd like your host up and walking around so they can give you to other people.
I mean, as you can see with Ebola, even though it incapacitates its victims, they still transmit the infection because people are taking care of them. And it's spread by contact, so that's
quite it's almost a healthcare vector disease.
So we have this general idea, and this is a totally human interpretation, that a virus should evolve to be maximally infectious and minimally virulent, right? Because that you don't want to kill the host. But in fact, we rarely see that. You know, the example of the introduction of myxoma virus into Australia to kill the rabbits. First year it was 99% lethal. And then over subsequent years, the rabbit and the virus evolved, and it dropped to 40%, but that's still quite lethal.
Right.
Yeah.
And in terms of human viruses, I don't know of any where we've seen this trend because we haven't been studying them long enough. Now, HIV was introduced into people relatively recently. So if we study that for another 50 or 100 years, maybe we'll see a trend. Maybe it will become better adapted to humans and cause less disease. But a priori, as Alan said, I don't know why it has to do that. Now, Ebola, what would happen with Ebola? So Ebola transmits quite well by contact. What kind of evolutionary pressure would make sense for it? I mean, I don't know. It seems to me that it does quite well. I mean, it could become more infectious because the reproductive index is only between 1 and 2, but I don't know. I've never seen a virus do that, so I'm not sure. So
this is a virus that transmits about as well as hepatitis C, and it's direct contact. And I mean, you say it does quite well. It's certainly doing well in humans in this current epidemic. That's not, as far as we can tell, that's not its natural host. So this is a virus that has its own thing going on, probably in bats, where it has probably been for a very, very, very long time. And whatever it is that drives the Ebola replication in that host is still going to be in the virus's interest. So what is in the virus's interest in humans? Is it even in the virus's interest to be in humans? Given that, I mean, we say it spreads readily by contact, but it doesn't spread readily by any other means. And as soon as you have contact precautions taken in a place, that's the end of its transmission route. So I don't see that there's a lot of selective pressure for it to do anything, really.
Right. If all the bats went away, in other words, if it lost that host, then maybe there would be some reason for the virus to then go through a different course of evolution in other hosts like people. But in the absence of bats going away, if we were to snuff out, as has happened in the past outbreaks, if we snuff out this Ebola outbreak, then it's a dead end for Ebola until the next zoonotic transfer.
And if it do, if the bats do go extinct, which is always a possibility because more and more species, especially bats, are being driven to extinction, then the virus wouldn't know that that was happening, so to speak. And I don't think that would add any pressure to adapt in humans either. The most likely scenario is that the virus would go extinct with the bats.
Yeah.
This is a disease, just to reiterate for people who are just tuning into TWiV, this is a social disease in the truest sense. It's a disease that is spread by social conditions in which you have some of the trappings of modern healthcare, meaning a hospital that people go to, but you don't have any of the functioning administrative or government structures that would proper procedures and proper staffing for that facility. And then that becomes the nexus of a whole bunch of infections, and then people get afraid of the hospital. And so this is a social phenomenon, really, more than a virological one.
Yeah, and there's actually a good article in NPR Shots on the reproductive index of Ebola virus, or what's called R-naught, which we've talked about. How many people on average during an outbreak will be infected by a single infected person. So for HCV, as Alan mentioned, it's 2. For Ebola, it's 2. HIV is 4. The best ones are like measles, which is 18. And that's probably in part because it's spread by aerosol. Yet HIV has done very well at 4.
Right.
Yeah, that's a really effective graphic.
The graphic is wonderful,
I just kind of skimmed the rest of the article because I thought the graphic just told the whole story.
Yeah.
Now, reproductive index, I had a little discussion with Lynn Enquist at the airport yesterday. So this is a number based on an outbreak. You trace back the infections to the person they got it from, and you say, oh, this person on average during an outbreak can infect 1 or 2 people. That's where the number comes from. But it's an average during an outbreak. It doesn't mean that a person cannot infect more. And in fact, we've seen examples of one person infecting 5 or 10 other people. That's fine. But the point is that on average in an outbreak, it's going to be, 2 for Ebola.
Yeah.
And along with that article, which we'll link to, there has been a it is another article in PLOS Currents where they estimate the reproduction number based on the numbers in the outbreak today. And they use various mathematical formulas. They make assumptions which they say could influence the outcome, but their number is, between 1 and 2, just like it's been previously determined. So it fits in quite well. All right, back to Alan's letter. All the way up.
Listener pick now.
Listener pick, updated daily, linking to articles and giving brief summaries and some commentary. Started during H5N1 outbreak and expanded to include all disease outbreaks. Excellent site. It's called H5N1 by Croft is the guy's name.
And oh, yeah.
Croft is a graduate of Columbia University. And we picked this. We picked this. And TWiV, it's very good. He just combs the literature, the outbreak news, and puts all these little quotes from them left and right. And We picked this on TWiV number 23. Wow, that was a long time ago.
Yeah.
Pick it again. It's good. Alan is a retired engineer. Look at that, Alan.
Yeah.
We're back to Kathy with Wink.
Okay, Wink writes, it sounds like the panel assumes that public health interventions are known to be effective. I do not believe that has ever been the case. Please consider the following. Number one, cholera was waning in London before John Snow's intervention. Dr. Snow wrote, the attacks had so far diminished before the use of the water was stopped that it is impossible to decide whether the well still contained the cholera poison in an active state. Two, deaths from influenza the year of novel H1N1 were the same as usual, around 36,000, despite enhanced public health efforts. 3. Polio was controlled thanks to university research and ethical pharmaceutical production. 4. The incidence of HIV in the United States is remarkably constant, about 60,000 new cases, while prevalence steadily rises. If I knew of any clear public health success stories, I would list them, but I can't think of any.
Flush toilets.
Yes.
Rural electrification.
Yeah, I count seatbelts.
Yep.
Campaigns against cigarette smoking, and I could make an argument for every infectious disease case that he mentions.
Yes.
So I, for instance, found this graph of HIV prevalence and incidence from 1980 to 2010, and the number of people living with HIV, it started increasing again. That's presumably because the plateau is potentially because of public health interventions to get people to not have unsafe sex and other kinds of things. And then the increase is probably because now more people are living with AIDS because of HART, the highly active antiretroviral therapy. So I think this graph points to success for HIV, and as I said, I could make an argument for each of these other ones as well. So
polio just, absolutely.
Yeah, I think we just have a different.
Well, I think he doesn't consider a pharmaceutical as part of public health. Public health, yeah, I think he's interpreting as just making, like we were talking about in the Ebola episode last time, you know, quarantine, tracking cases, and so forth. But that has worked to limit the outbreaks previously.
SARS.
SARS was a great. We had no drugs, right?
Yeah. We still can't do much about it, but it got contained through public health interventions.
Now flu doesn't.
And if you're saying that, you know, distribution of a vaccine is not a public health effort, then what are you saying about H1N1?
I think the problem with H1N1 is that first, it's people don't do the thing. They don't wash their hands. They don't do the right things, and they don't get vaccinated.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, and the polio story that he brings up, yeah, it was university and pharmaceutical research, but who got people to get that vaccine? That was a huge, huge public health effort.
Sure.
And yeah, there's no other way to characterize it. It was not the clinics that were set up to vaccinate everybody against polio were not being...
Yeah, nor the pharmaceuticals. The companies weren't saying, you know, go out and get our vaccine because we want to sell more vaccine.
Right.
So
my story was guinea worm eradication. So
yes,
this has been pushed by Jimmy Carter and his foundation. A guinea worm is transmitted to people through the water they drink. And all he did was have them filter the water through sari cloth and modify their way where they got their drinking water.
So Rita Colwell.
With cholera?
Yes, she's the one with cholera who figured out the same thing. Probably predates the Carter Foundation's work. She figured out that if you filter the water through four layers of cloth, you eliminate the Vibrios because they're attached to plankton in the water.
Yeah.
So yeah, and that was successful, and where it's consistently implemented, it's continued to be successful.
Okay, Alan, can you take the next one?
Sure. Topher writes, greetings, Twivers. My name is Topher, and I'm writing in response to Dawn's email on episode 304. Dawn, it seems to me you haven't listened to TWiV very much. It is also very apparent that you haven't listened to episode 297. If you had, you would have heard their well-researched and in-depth discussion of Ebola. Additionally, you mistook a desire for accuracy for a complete lack of knowledge. I'm 100% sure they could have all given you an estimate of the incubation period pretty darn close to what it is, which Vincent actually did. There is a difference between not remembering what kind of fruit a tomato is and not knowing what a tomato is at all. In the desire for an accurate statement, he asked if they remembered, which led them to them looking it up. This desire for accuracy, even in an off-the-cuff statement, should be applauded, not denounced. It also seems you might have a certain expectation of what the discussion of Ebola should sound like, one that is likely informed by media coverage that is all too often suffused with misinformation. You really should have listened to more TWiV before you wrote in. I might have been more inclined to agree with you, except, damn, for you to not know the difference between a lack of precision and complete ignorance, simple things you don't even know, this is borrowing language from Dawn's letter, maybe you should stick to writing into podcasts you know more about, i.e. not TWiV. Thank you, Topher.
I'm afraid Dawn isn't listening anymore.
Probably not, but...
All right, Peter writes, Dear Twivers, many thanks for the excellent podcasts. I've only relatively recently been switched onto them and am still catching up. I have really been impressed with the way you have covered Ebola, or should I say Ebola virus disease, EVD. When I say impressed, I don't mean to give the impression that I'm an expert, but rather I can appreciate how you strike a balance in your discussions. I'm not part of any response to EVD, but I do, as one part of my day job, give infection prevention and control advice to care homes. As we are approaching norovirus season and following your discussions on EVD transmission, I got to wondering what allows some viruses to gain entry to the body via mucosal membranes like Hep B and C, and others to stick to a fecal-oral or vomitous-oral pathway like norovirus, and how can EVD do both? While I'm clear and agree with you about EVD transmission, there's no evidence of airborne transmission. Maybe using the terms vomitous-oral or vomitous mucosal pathway allows people to draw a clearer mental picture.
Crystal clear, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And on the subject of vomit, may I suggest the following video clip as a listener's pick of the week, which shows on two levels why viruses in vomit are so transmissible, their spread and difficulties in cleaning up.
Yes, this is the Vomiting Larry video, which yes. I picked in TWiV 233, and it's really effective to show my class, too. So good for Peter for reminding us about that.
Keep up the great work. By the way, the sun has just broken through the clouds, and it is a pleasant 20 Celsius and 75% relative humidity. Pete's over in England. Why viruses are transmitted? Well, that's a very good question. It has some to do with where they replicate, right? If you're replicating in the intestines, like polio and norovirus, you get spread by fecal oral transmission, or vomit, could be both. You know, hepatitis B and C mostly used to be transfusions, and now IV drug use, and probably also for Hep B during birth. But those are unusual. They've evolved to be produced that way, to transmit that way, because they replicate and form a viremia, which allows them to be spread by that route. So that's why HIV is spread by the blood supply as well. EVD can do both. So I view EVD as, it's just replicating everywhere. And the virus is coming out both ends. It's in the skin. It's in sweat. It's in mucus. And why it does that is anybody's guess. I view it as, in the bat, it's nicely adapted, and it's got this regulation and this negotiation with the bat. But when it gets into a different host, all that's gone, and it goes crazy, and it replicates everywhere. But I don't know. I'm just speculating.
Yeah, I think a lot of this has to do with this not being the natural host.
Yeah.
And up until now, humans were mostly a dead end for Ebola.
Yep. Kathy, you're next.
So the next one is from Cameron, and he sends us a link to an article where Anthony Branberry, the chief of the United Nations Ebola mission, says there's a chance that the deadly virus could mutate to become infectious through the air. So then Cameron writes, Hi again, guys and gals. I can't believe the media. How irresponsible is this? Nothing to say how this could actually happen other than viruses mutate. I assume it is scare tactics to make the authorities take the epidemic seriously. My worry is that this kind of public panic will create far worse problems than Ebola virus ever could. Also, in seeing the response in Texas, one case of Ebola and an ambulance is taken off the road. Don't they know about bleach? If they use up an ambulance every time they have a patient infected with a virus, they better buy a whole lot more ambulances. Do they do that when they transport a patient that turns out to have hepatitis C? Keep up the great work, guys. It seems that the world needs some common sense more than ever, and you guys are the voice of reason when it comes to virology. Cheers, Cameron. And I really couldn't bring myself to read that article in the Telegraph in detail, but I did skim it, and I got to the end and was happy to see that they had contacted Professor David Heyman, Chair of Public Health England and Professor of Infectious Disease Epidemiology at the London Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, who said that no virus transmitted by bodily fluids, as Ebola is, has ever mutated to airborne transmission.
I would say even broader, no virus has changed the way it's transmitted, as far as we know.
Right. I thought not within a particular host, no.
I thought we'd be done with this, but I guess it's going to linger on forever, right?
It's going to linger on forever because it's the news hook that won't die. Yep. It's, you know, how do we keep scaring people about this so that the story still sounds relevant to them, and this is how you keep scaring people about it.
And it's unfortunate that it's somebody with the gravitas, potentially, of the chief of the United Nations Ebola mission saying this kind of thing.
How does he know this? He's not, I mean, is he talking to someone who told him this? Because
I couldn't make it through the article, but I'm not sure what the context, the entire context was of the conversation in which this was stated. But, you know, and of course, if you press somebody, is it possible that this could happen? Of course it's possible, you know.
Pigs can fly. Yeah.
Yeah, pigs can fly. Give them enough evolutionary time, and they can. They won't be pigs by the time they do, but they could.
By the way, we are doing this as a Google Hangout today because I'm at home. I just got back from Brazil, and I don't have my usual recording equipment, so the audio is not the usual pristine quality that you're used to, so I'm sorry about that, but at least you get a TWiV. And it's not a pre-recorded one, because I know if I used the pre-recorded one this weekend, you'd get mad that it's not Ebola. Okay, so, well, the noises you're hearing,
And you can get video, right? This will be archived, right?
It's going to be video, yep, there'll be video up as well. All right, Alan, I believe you're next.
Okay, Tom writes, today's New York Times, it's October 2nd, so that's yesterday. Had a front page article on Ebola. Interesting to note that first USA victim of Ebola was symptomatic, told the staff he had recently been in Liberia, was sent home anyway. He returned 2 days later and was then admitted, diagnosed with Ebola. Government and health officials seem more interested in CYA than public health. I'll let the viewers expand the acronym. The public should demand the dismissal of any such officials knowingly lying about this event. While quote-unquote experts claim that Ebola is only transmitted by contact with bodily fluids from an Ebola victim actually demonstrating symptoms, they also claim to be running around wiping down surfaces with what is apparently an alcohol-based hand cleaner. From what I've read, these hand cleaners are effective for bacteria and some viruses. I think even you and your guests will admit that our real knowledge of Ebola is limited at best. Kathy, you wanted to interject something here.
Well, I would just beg to differ with our real knowledge of Ebola is limited at best. We have quite a bit of information about it since its discovery in 1976. We know that it's an enveloped virus. The treatment of enveloped viruses with ethanol can be efficacious if you have a high enough concentration of alcohol, and especially if you have a mix of ethanol and isopropanol. I don't know exactly what Tom is referring to, but yes, the non-envelope viruses, such as norovirus, the ethanol-based hand cleaners aren't going to do anything at all. But in the absence of anything else, treating for Ebola or something that's enveloped with an alcohol-based solution be better than nothing.
And I'm frantically trying. I'm not on my usual browser because we're doing the Hangout. I'm trying to get a PubMed search going up, but I am pretty sure that we actually have specific data about Ebola virus inactivation. So this isn't just, it's an envelope virus and it should be inactivated. I think the experiment's actually been done, if I'm not mistaken.
In fact, CDC and WHO say you can use an alcohol-based sanitizer to inactivate infectivity.
Yeah, so the example of how this is not a tremendously easy virus to get. You can disinfect easily with alcohol or with bleach or with probably other sanitizers. And it's transmitted by direct contact. So, all right, I'll go ahead and continue with the letter because I'll have some comments at the end, too. So Tom continues, the fact there's no quarantine on people leaving countries that are currently undergoing epidemics of Ebola is inexcusable. The front page of today's New York Times shows a four-year-old girl lying on a floor covered by bodily fluids but from Ebola victims. It shows exactly how far all America's well-publicized efforts to help deal with Ebola in Africa have progressed. What are the 1,000 people we sent to help doing? Or have they even left? What is their mission outside of propaganda showing our efforts to help Africa in the Ebola epidemic? While I agree there's apparently no evidence to indicate Ebola can be spread by airborne droplets, I certainly claim some of the statements, such as the disease can only be transmitted while the victim's symptomatic, is probably based on too limited data sample to be taken as ground truth. All right, we'll get to all this at the end. So let me just get through this. While USA Today lacks the reputation of the New York Times, it's already indicating we're possibly up to 2 American Ebola victims, the second stemming from the so-called first victim of Ebola here in the U.S., with the incubation period being as long as 3 weeks. Who knows what awaits us? Let me reiterate, the first U.S. Ebola victim was obviously symptomatic when he first went to the hospital and was turned away. Your team isn't among the crowd who dismisses Ebola by saying more people die in car wrecks or the flu than Ebola. This misses the point. And yes, millions more die of malaria in Africa, so Ebola is a joke in terms of sheer numbers. Americans don't care about that because malaria is no threat to the average American. This isn't a criticism, just a fact. Is the Ebola cat out of the bag? I suspect it is, yet the public's been fed a lot of malarkey based on practically no thorough scientific investigation or knowledge of Ebola. Poo-pooing idiots who don't know squat about Ebola and make claims about aerosol spreading the disease is all well and good, but I think you should also address the fact going on about no bodyists on this disease, limited numbers, and viewing it as an African problem. And by the time of your next podcast, who knows what the USA Ebola victim count will be. Let's be sure your podcast doesn't change the statement, the truism in time of war, the first victim is truth, to in the case of Ebola, the first victim is truth. Okay, Tom. We have more from Tom later.
Same Tom?
Yeah, it's a different topic, so I think you can address
it. Okay, all right. So, about this whole lack of knowledge on Ebola, you're wrong. We know an enormous amount about this virus. It has actually been studied way out of proportion to the number of infections that have occurred historically. This is something that has been worked on really, really extensively. And if you search a website called PubMed, which will allow you to search the peer-reviewed biomedical research, you will find that is the case. You'll find an enormous amount of work that's been done on Ebola answering many of the questions that you're trying to raise here. Now, some of the other issues, why haven't we quarantined the countries where Ebola is happening? First of all, that doesn't work. Historically, that has not been a successful route. And secondly, it generally tends to make things worse. Because if you implement or try to implement some kind of a quarantine on a country, the very first thing that will happen is people will try to flee that country bypassing the quarantine, and then you completely lose track of them. So that's not a good idea at all. And this notion that the New York Times running a photo of a four-year-old girl lying on the floor disproves that anybody's gone over there to help is kind of preposterous, because a news photographer's job is to find interesting, newsworthy photos. So they're going to go to the very place where they can find an interesting and newsworthy photo, and that's not going to be the place where everything has been brought into order.
They're going to put that on the top half of the front page of the paper.
Yes.
Potentially sell newspapers.
Exactly.
For those people who still buy hard copy newspapers.
And if you don't buy hard copy newspapers, it's going to be on the front page of the website. So, right. this is what the market demands, and this is what the photographers are going to get. Nothing against the photojournalists. It's a noble profession, but they are assigned to go there and find the news. And there's a lot of this phenomenon has been documented in many, many situations where they will deliberately go to, of course, the place where the most interesting thing is happening. So that's always what you're going to see. The news is skewed in that respect. This thing with the American Ebola victims and seems to be edging toward this notion that this is going to become some huge thing in the U.S. I think that's preposterous for precisely the same reasons that malaria is not a big deal in the U.S. We have an infrastructure that precludes it from happening. It's not that malaria can't be transmitted in the U.S. In fact, historically, it used to be. This was a huge problem in colonial days. There would be epidemics of malaria every summer. And then at some point in history, it just magically went away. Why? Because everybody installed window screens. So we have an infrastructure that precludes these sorts of problems. And yes, it is a concern that somebody showed up in the U.S., developed symptoms of Ebola virus, has the virus, and was walking around out there. And they're doing contact tracing out of an abundance of caution about that.
I just went to Croft's blog just to see what the latest was with respect to this second potential Ebola case, and I didn't find anything about that, but I did find where the spokesman for the United Nations Secretary General says that the UN believes air travel to and from the West African countries should continue. It's very important not to isolate these countries, the person said, as it would worsen their political and economic situations. Aid groups need access to the region. So that's not, it goes along with what you were saying, Alan, that quarantine is not in the best interest.
And given that this is a political and economic disease, destroying the economy of Liberia further is not going to be helpful.
So let me give you my thoughts on this, because I spent some hours thinking about it. Now, there are many countries that could not handle imported cases of Ebola, as we do. And there are many, many of them that don't have a good health infrastructure or any kind of preparedness that would let them. And I don't want a dozen countries having imported cases and having their own outbreaks with thousands and thousands of cases. So I thought yesterday that closing down travel except for healthcare workers would be a reasonable approach. Now, if you remember, China did install temperature detectors during the SARS outbreak. So anyone with a temperature couldn't go out, and that would help at least in this case. Wouldn't get everyone, because you could still be incubating the virus and not have a temperature. Subsequently, I did read a number of papers that looked at the risk of spreading the virus from Africa. So there's a brand new paper in PLOS Currents, well, it's not brand, it's a month old, assessing the international spreading risk associated with the outbreak in West Africa. So they basically conclude the short-term 3 to 6 week probability of international spread is small but not negligible. The extension of the outbreak is more likely to occur in African countries, thereby increasing the risk of international dissemination on a longer time scale. So I understand that blocking travel has its own consequences, but I'm looking at the cases going out of the country now, and I think this is a real problem. I don't see, and short of really getting it under control in the countries, how are you going to prevent this from happening? So that article says it's a low probability, and then a month later it happened, right?
Right. Well, it happened, but, and you're saying there are a lot of countries that wouldn't be able to handle this, but I'm not sure there are quite as many as you think. I keep coming back to the example of Uganda, which is, you know, not a wealthy first world country, but their experience with Ebola, they had outbreaks historically and hundreds of people died. Then they got a functioning government and a really kind of minimally functioning healthcare system. They were able to implement the proper procedures, and now sporadically you'll get one case, two cases, virtually no spread. So if a country like Uganda can do it, why can't many, many other countries that we might not think of as being highly advanced economically handle this equally well?
Well, You know, it could happen, right?
Of course.
Just because Uganda did it doesn't mean that.
No, and they were, and I understand that they were keen to deal with it because they had this happening there, whereas someplace, you know, Latin American countries may not have had, since they have had no experience with this, they may not have had as much motivation to put those procedures in place. But I don't see this as I see the risks of stopping travel to and from these countries as far greater than the or rather the harms of stopping travel to and from these countries is far greater than the risk that's posed by allowing it.
Look, it took them months to diagnose Ebola as causing this problem in these countries.
And yeah,
part of the problem why it's getting out of control. And can you imagine it getting into a country that has no experience with handling Ebola, taking a couple of months, and by then it's in hundreds of people, and there's just no way it's going to be stemmed at that point, because as Jeff said last week, then they can't do case tracking anymore.
I would hope that at this point everybody kind of expects it.
Yeah.
Well, in Dallas, the guy said he was in Liberia, and they sent him home.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Tom, continue. Why don't you continue with Tom? He got on to insects.
Okay, yes. Tom wrote again. There seems to be no evidence AIDS can be transmitted by a mosquito bite from someone infected with AIDS to someone not infected. He's referring to HIV, the virus that causes AIDS. AIDS certainly can be transmitted from a hypodermic needle used by someone infected by AIDS. Since I believe far more blood is injected into a potential AIDS victim by a mosquito than a hypodermic needle, I conclude there must be some factor inherent to a mosquito that prevents transmission. I wonder if any research was ever done to see if there's some component in a mosquito that kills or renders the AIDS virus harmless. If so, perhaps this information could be used to produce a vaccine. Are you aware of any such study or of interest to me why a mosquito does not appear capable of spreading AIDS? The premise of the argument is wrong, because a mosquito did not inject blood from its previous meal into its next host. It injects saliva, whereas a contaminated needle is actually going to provide direct blood-to-blood contact. Mosquitoes do not provide direct blood-to-blood contact. Their behavior pattern is that they feed, and then after feeding, the female mosquito is completely loaded with blood, can barely fly, goes and rests and digests the meal. And then after that meal has been digested, and she lays eggs, she goes and she finds another host and feeds again. So there's a whole cycle that goes on there, and viruses that can be spread by mosquito have gone through a substantial amount of evolution to be able to capitalize on that.
In fact, that was the premise of the journal club that we had this morning about the plant virus, where they were looking at how does the virus get from the midgut, which is essentially the stomach of the insect, out into the rest of the body, into the hemolymph, so that it can get to the saliva where it needs to be transmitted. And this particular virus seems to have evolved a tubule mechanism that allows it to do that. So the virus itself has to be very well adapted to life in the insect, and then in this case in the plant as well. But in the case of HIV or Ebola, the virus is going to have to adapt to the insect host and the mammalian host. And
as they say in engineering, this is not a trivial problem.
Yeah.
So I found a website by a guy at Rutgers who it's called Why Mosquitoes Cannot Transmit AIDS, and he talks about these issues. So basically, the HIV is inactivated in the stomach of the mosquito. It's digested, and it never makes its way to the salivary gland. And he said also it could be that the mosquito could get virus on its mouth parts, or could somehow get blood on the next person. But he said there's not enough viremia with HIV to prevent that. So he basically
to allow that.
So it's not happening with HIV. We know that for sure. So I've got to put a link to that. There's another article I found. Can we get AIDS from mosquito bites? From 1999. Again, the virus does not replicate in the mosquito. And it's got a low titer in the blood, so this is not happening. So some viruses, one virus I know of, can be transmitted without replicating in the host. I've forgotten which one it is now because it's such high titer in the infected animal. But most have to replicate, get from the gut to the salivary gland, as has been pointed out. And then he sent another link later about, so this is all part of our discussion of could Ebola virus be insect transmitted, and we talked about AIDS, and that's why this is coming up. There's a website from Stanford. It's might be part of a course or something. It's just called Are Insects Ebola's Natural Reservoir? And it provides some suggestions. A single replication study conducted during the late 1970s suggested that Marburg virus could replicate in mosquitoes. However, the paper is in a German journal that I couldn't find. And anyway, Marburg is not Ebola, right? So there's very little evidence as far as I see. Now, it says in this website that we really need to study this more, but as far as I know, there's no epidemiological evidence indicating that a bite is a risk factor for getting Ebola.
No. No, and there are many good reasons why it shouldn't be.
This website is copyright 1999 by Tara Waterman, so it could be that it's just never been taken down.
And I don't even know.
From a class, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if this was a student paper submitted for a class, like discuss reasons why or why not this might happen, and this student then put it together. I don't know.
Yeah,
why this was put together, but it is not a very persuasive page.
It's this kind of thing you're going to find if you search for Ebola and insects, right?
Sure.
All right. Is it my turn? I don't remember. I think so. Matthias writes, Dear TWiV, I wondered if you want to talk about the Ebola conspiracy theories in a future episode, the accusation that Ebola was created and patented by the U.S. government. To be precise, I've seen this nonsense going around for months now, and 2 weeks ago, the Daily Observer, Liberia's largest newspaper, published an article claiming exactly that and was dutifully quoted by all the virology on the Facebook, which, despite the name, was a reliable page until then. What the conspiracy theory refers to is a patent for Bundibugyo, which was applied for but never granted, and he gives a link to that. The application obviously refers to an isolated strain and methods to detect it, not some way of creating the virus itself. The problem is that it is unsurprisingly written in a very dense and technical style, and laypersons will almost certainly get the wrong impression from it, that is, if they even bother to read beyond the headline. To find out that the patent was never granted in the first place takes active research that nobody is going to do either. I found only one article where a life sciences patent lawyer explicitly debunks all this, and it's in German. So I would be happy to translate if you decide to do this. So Bundibugyo is one of the more recent new isolates, which was isolated by the government of the U.S. in Africa and in Uganda, and the CDC submitted a patent application. It wasn't granted, but they certainly didn't make it. They don't know how to make it. Nobody knows how to make a virus. It's absurd. It's totally absurd.
Which is probably why the patent was denied, because you can't patent a life form. Yeah.
I think they probably were going for diagnostics or something.
Of course. This is the type of patent you would file, especially back in the boom times of the biotech industry, and you want a company to commercialize ways to detect this virus, so you're going to have to protect the intellectual property around it. So what do? You file a patent on the virus so that you can detect it.
So this, and although it's it is dense, if you get into the description, it's actually not even that dense. But in the abstract, it tells you that compositions are provided that are operable as immunogens to elicit immune response or protection from the challenge by the virus in a subject such as a primate. Inventive methods are directed to detection and treatment of the infection.
So this is to make vaccines and diagnostics.
Right.
Yeah, it's a standard thing you do. You isolate a virus, you try and do this. You don't get it, you move on. It's no conspiracy. In fact, Cheryl, the next letter said, why did the U.S. government have a patent on Ebola? Why would it want to do that? Well, it submitted one for the reasons we just said, just to try and cover this. But apparently it was not awarded, right, according to Matthias.
And even if it was, that would have been fine.
Well, I don't know if they would ever do anything with it. I don't know if they would license it to anyone, right?
Well, sure, if somebody wanted to develop a diagnostic kit for this thing and they wanted to take on the risk of doing that, the main risk being that there'd eventually be no market for it. Yeah, you'd want that to be patented to tell your investors that nobody else is going to beat us to this after we've done all the hard work.
Okay, so if the government wanted some company to work on something that would protect the company, that would be the idea.
Absolutely, and in fact, under the Bayh-Dole Act, you just about have to file for patents on stuff like this.
Okay, so our patent lawyers who are listening, just let us know if we're right on that.
Yeah, please fill me in on that, but I'm pretty sure that this is something that is just standard procedure.
All right. We should bring you up to date on the situation with Ebola. So far, 7,157 cases, 3,330 deaths. And as we've talked about and others have noted, that's probably an underestimate and not up to date, as Jeff told us last week. Apparently in Nigeria, things have stopped spreading. They seem to have controlled the outbreak, which you may remember. An infected individual went from Liberia to Nigeria, and he exposed 72 other people, and 19 laboratory-confirmed cases, 894 identified contacts. So this is what you need to do. But, of course, if you have one infected person, it can be done. So that's over, apparently. There hasn't been a case since September sometime, right?
Right. And this is Nigeria.
This is Nigeria. So this is good. And Nigeria can't get rid of polio, but they can do this. So this is really nice.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a good story. So there's MMWR has a nice story on it. New York Times also had a very nice story. And then, of course, we've already talked about the Texas story. It's gotten a lot of coverage in the Times. ProMed Mail has a very nice summary of what happened, as does the CDC. A man traveled to Dallas from Liberia, and a few days afterwards, he went to the emergency room. He was sick, and as I said earlier, he told them he'd been to Liberia, but apparently the physician didn't get that information, so he was sent home.
Yeah, what I heard was it had to do with electronic records that
something
maybe
screwed up.
It either got in or didn't get in or just wasn't seen or whatever. Yeah.
So a healthcare worker takes the history, right? And then the physician looks at it. It seems to me that physicians should want to know the travel history. If it's not in the electronic record, that's fine. But he or she sort of said, where has this person been, right?
Right.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think it'll happen again probably after this. So anyway, later he came back and they isolated him and samples are positive for Ebola. So now they're tracing all his contacts and seeing and watching them, including a couple of school kids, right?
Mm-hmm. Five. And they're quarantining his family and bringing in food and groceries for the next groceries and water and whatever for the next 21 days.
Now, according to ProMed Mail, he had helped carry someone, a pregnant woman who was sick, to the hospital in Liberia. She was turned away because it was full and died that evening, but he helped transport her in the car, and that may be how he got infected, but who knows? There's so many rumors spreading about that.
Right. And evidently, there's a departure form that people fill out on leaving Liberia. And he checked that no, he hadn't had contact with anybody from Ebola. So now the Liberian government is claiming that they're going to arrest him on his return because he lied on his form.
That's the least of his concerns at this point, actually.
Exactly.
If he makes it back, right?
If he decides to go back, yeah.
Right, yeah.
So, I mean, I would suspect that he's going to survive because he's getting the right, the intravenous treatments and so forth. But, I mean, he really should not have done this, right? But this is going to happen over and over no matter what you do. People will always try and go where they're not supposed to go.
Yeah.
So that's the first unintentional importation of Ebola into the U.S., right?
Yep.
Is there something else going on about in terms of Ebola in the U.S.?
Not that I could find from the Crofts blog in a quick look. I didn't get all the way back to where I'd read it yesterday, so.
Okay.
Yeah, the news is really dominated by this case in Texas.
There's still a couple of suspected cases in various places around the U.S., but nothing confirmed yet that I can see.
So I think this is a good example of how it should work. This patient came in. The second time he had the right, they got his travel history, they isolated him, send samples to CDC, it's Ebola positive, he's isolated and treated, and it's not going to spread most likely.
Right.
And this should happen in most countries with good response programs put in place, right?
Or even marginally adequate response programs, yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I don't have the same feeling that you do for this. I'm just worried that we're going to have a dozen outbreaks all over the world. And if we can stop it, let's do it now. But there, people, you know, the epidemiologists say it's a low priority, it's a low possibility event. Okay. So apparently they're not shutting down transportation. So let's see what happens. Now, how did Rich Condit get involved here, Kathy?
He sent us this email yesterday, and he said, I wonder if Lhasa doesn't provide a model for what to expect. There's a steady state annual 5,000 fatalities, and human-to-human transmission is possible, though I don't know how efficient. I wonder how often it is exported, this is Lhasa, and whether or not there are problems with spread. I certainly don't recall much news about it. Maybe it's mostly rural in Africa, and that makes a difference. Just a thought. Also, he gave a link, and the case fatality ratio for Lhasa is really only about 1%, according to this link, and it's up to 15% in hospitalized cases. So that could be a big difference between Lhasa and Ebola.
Maybe we should do a Lhasa episode one day.
Yeah.
Maybe we should.
There's a lot of viruses we could cover.
Call it Lhasa Come Home.
So I wanted to throw this out. So we got caught with Ebola. We really should have had vaccines and antivirals, right? But we didn't because we didn't give it the priority. There's actually a Business Week article this week with this horrid cover with dripping blood letters saying Ebola is coming. The article inside is actually quite good. It goes through why the monoclonal antibody therapy never made it very far, because Ebola was classified as a bioweapons threat, and the Department of Defense took over driving the research, and they didn't think it was important, so it basically stalled. It's actually quite a good read. So in hindsight, you can always be smart, right? But now let's see if we can learn. What do you think we should be ready for with vaccines and antivirals besides Ebola? What viruses? I mean, I know it's going to cost money, but let's say the countries of the world decide money is not an object. What should we get ready for? Would Lhasa be one of them?
Maybe.
Potentially, yeah.
How about MERS?
MERS, SARS. I'd go for influenza.
Well, people are trying to do that, right?
And that's already, sure. There are already stockpiles of vaccines against H5N1 and H7N9, I think. Yeah.
I would say Nipah and Hendra, too. Who knows, mm-hmm. right?
Mm-hmm. Sure. But in the context of all these efforts to develop technology, I think what often gets shortchanged is that the underlying causes of a lot of these problems are not virological or technological. You know, it's fine to have a technological solution for the people who can afford it, but the reason Liberia is having this outbreak is not because there isn't a vaccine. The reason Liberia is having this outbreak is because they don't have a properly functioning country. And okay. I know that's a much harder, it seems like a much harder or more nebulous issue to address, but a lot of the things that could be done to fix that just haven't been. And that, I think, is what's unconscionable here.
Well, the thing is that if we had a vaccine or antiviral, we could have stopped it long ago, no?
No, I'm not convinced of that at all.
We have a vaccine for polio.
We have vaccines for measles, mumps, rubella, diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus. I mean, we've got anti-malarial drugs. We've got all kinds of vaccines and treatments. We have a very effective post-exposure vaccine for rabies, and we can't even control human rabies.
So why are we pushing ZMAP and vaccines now forward if we think they're not going to work?
Because we love technological solutions for social problems. You know, gee, if everybody in Africa just had a laptop, then all their problems would go away. So you get the one laptop per child program, and they ship a bunch of laptop computers over there, and guess what? You know, they still don't have an internet connection.
I think vaccines and therapeutics are important to be working on. It's just that we have to recognize that that's not going to be the solution to everything. And when Alan was talking about, you know, what if somebody with Ebola went to a Latin American country that didn't recognize it at first and wasn't prepared for it because they don't have an infrastructure that's prepared for that, whereas Uganda now does. In some ways, it's a matter of distribution of resources. You spend your resources on what you think is the most important thing, problem that you're going to face. And if in Latin America it hasn't been Ebola, then they're not necessarily going to be as prepared for it.
But you can, in terms of preparedness generally, the best thing to do is to get information out there about how you can have multi-use technologies. I mean, the protective equipment to prevent transmission of Ebola is not some sophisticated 21st century iPhone 6 type device. We're talking about rubber suits and gloves here.
Right.
So these are the types of things you can say, hey, look, everybody in Africa, Latin America, Asia, wherever you are, your country should be prepared to deal with viruses that are contagious by contact. The way you do this is that you have an adequate supply of latex gloves and N95 masks or whatever, you know, you decide is an appropriate equivalent measure. These are not hard things to get. They're not hard to stockpile. They keep for a long time. The technology is well proven, and it's usable against all kinds of stuff. So yeah, it's usable against Ebola. It's usable against Nipah or whatever other virus crops out of the wilderness. Just good stuff to have.
I think you're probably right about the vaccination because Tom Solomon weeks ago when I spoke with him, we sort of touched on this, and he said, "You think you can just go in there and give everybody a vaccine? They're gonna they don't even want to go to the hospital if they're sick."
And if we could just go in there and give everybody a vaccine, look at all the diseases we already would have cured there.
Yeah.
Well, I think this vaccine being pushed is mainly for healthcare workers.
Absolutely.
They're going to be somewhere else. You're going to immunize them. They're going to take it and then go there and have some semblance of, if not worrying about getting infected beyond the personal protective equipment. Right.
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 But so our conclusion is that if we had an effective vaccine or antiviral, it would not guarantee that this outbreak would be closed.
Right. I am all for doing basic research on these viruses that maybe don't kill a lot of people normally. You never know what's going to happen, and the more we know about the viral world, the better. And I'm in favor of doing at least getting through the preclinical studies on candidate vaccines if you find some interesting ones. Mm-hmm. But I would not favor pumping millions and millions of dollars into clinical trials for whatever hypothetical virus might come along.
Well, the problem with clinical trials is that if it's something that is only an outbreak of a few cases or small outbreaks, whatever, you're going to be hard-pressed to get that clinical data.
Yes. Yes. I mean, you could do a safety trial, but right. I would say going to that point, the money would be better spent on fixing infrastructure problems. I know it's unglamorous, and I know it doesn't get politicians reelected, and that's the problem, but that's where, you know, it's like the earlier thing about public health interventions. The stuff that saves lives is the indoor plumbing and the seatbelts.
Well, as you know, there's a general sense of criticism now emerging in this country that we should have had this already, and that's why I wanted to chat about this a little bit, that... Mm-hmm. You know, the decision was made that Ebola was not a high enough priority to do this. And, should we do it in the future for other viruses or not? To get there, you're going to do basic research because you're going to have to figure out how to deliver antigens, which antigens, what's the correlative protection. I mean, that's going to take a while, and that's going to tell us interesting stuff. You're going to learn stuff, And yes. You're going to learn things you didn't expect you were going to learn, right?
And so, you're going to learn things that will help you probably in dealing with other viruses.
Sure, sure. Basically, we need to put more money in basic research.
Yes.
We don't necessarily have to make a lot of vaccines, but $30 billion a year for the NIH is really not enough.
Yeah.
Is that a story arc?
Yeah, it sure is.
I think that has come up a few times, yes.
Sure, and in fact, we got an article mailed to us today from someone in the department about a New York Times story about funding and young investigators and how there needs to be changes so that we're not demoralizing all of the young investigators. And, yeah, we could go there too.
Why don't we do some picks of the week?
Did you want to do the EVD68 uptake?
Yeah, we could mention it, yeah. So enterovirus D68, CDC says now 500 confirmed cases in 42 states. These are respiratory illnesses by enterovirus D68. So when we talked about it a couple of weeks ago, it was far fewer than that. It was just in a couple of Midwestern states, remember?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. 42 states. So this is really, I guess, part of the reason for its spread is going back to school, right?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Now, the interesting part here is that there have been four deaths. Four patients died.
The U.S. mortality rate of enterovirus D68 is now infinitely higher than that of Ebola.
Right.
Wait, why do you say that?
Right. How many people have died in the U.S. of Ebola?
Oh, yeah.
Zero.
Zero. Right. Four individuals die had they were positive for this virus. We don't know what if the virus caused their death or not. That's very difficult right. to sort out. And there have been 10 kids with now neurological problems, and some of them have the virus, but they also have some other viruses as well. So we don't know what's going on there. A group of 10 children in Colorado. Hospitalized with limb weakness, cranial nerve dysfunction, and abnormalities in their spinal gray matter. And Boston's children have four patients with the same symptoms. Michigan in Washtenaw County. So,
that's our county.
Now people are saying, how does this respiratory virus get into the CNS? CNS, if in fact that's what's happening, we don't know. But I'm not surprised. This is an enterovirus, like polio. Sure. Gets in the lung, it replicates, establishes a viremia, and can get into the CNS in rare cases. So I don't think this is too surprising. Yeah. But what's going on here is really not clear yet. This is just the beginning. It's not like Ebola. We know Ebola virus is causing this outbreak in Western Africa. We're just not sure here. So we'll follow that. Although maybe no one's interested, right? They want to hear
right. They want to hear about it.
I don't know. People are sick with stuff that's upper respiratory or respiratory of some sort. Someone I know, their son was in intensive care with... I never did find out whether EVD68 was confirmed, but that was definitely suspect.
Sure.
So
my daughter and I just got over a respiratory virus that I don't know what it was, but it was pretty annoying.
Yeah,
my wife somehow didn't get it, so I guess she—I don't know—she already had it or what. But
the interesting thing about D68 is that up until now, there have been less than 100 cases.
Yeah,
since 1960 something when it was first identified. So either we're getting better at detecting it, maybe that's a big part of it, or there's some other reason. But we'll follow. Yeah. Stay tuned.
Absolutely.
Let's do some picks now.
Okay.
Sure.
Kathy, what do you have?
I picked an Ebola thing. So back when we were doing our genetics of susceptibility project, and we were in full swing, I needed to use the UCSC genome browser a lot. That has genomes. First, I think human and mouse genomes were the first, and now there's lots and lots of organisms there. And we got, I'm still on the listserv for that. We got an email recently that they have a genome browser for Ebola, and they've set up a portal page where they link out quite nicely to viral zone and a couple other things from this link that I included, but also to the UCSC genome browser where they've compiled a bunch of Ebola virus sequences with some help from key players And even though I was moderately adept with the genome browser for the mouse genome, I can't quite figure it out for the Ebola virus sequences, but I just haven't spent the time with it. So if anybody's interested in sequences and accessing them there through the UCSC genome browser, it's available publicly out there.
This is nice.
You should put TWiV on. That thing at the bottom, general interest links. They have Nova. They have a couple of other song.
Right, right.
Here, guys, come on, give us a bump.
Yeah,
we're giving them a bump.
Mm-hmm.
Indeed, Alan, what do you have?
I have what will be a regular video podcast. This is just episode one of it. It's called Under the Knife. And the woman who does it is, I believe, she has a PhD in history of science or history of medicine. So she started this video cast series about the history of surgery. And it's I'm sure it's not an accident that she's starting this right before Halloween, which I think will get things off to. And she this episode one talks about the development of surgical saws. And it's very, very entertaining, very well done. It's just a few minutes long, but very well produced video. And I obviously she's got to get to episode 12 before we know if it'll persist. But it's a fun watch.
Cool.
All right. My pick is volume one of the annual review of virology. It's a brand new journal. These are actually books. That are put out by Annual Reviews Incorporated. There are many, many famous ones.
Michael, I screwed up your link. I'm sorry.
Yeah, the link doesn't work anymore, I noticed.
Yeah, I was trying to get my YouTube link in, and I think I can fix this.
Anyway, it's they started a new one. They have biochemistry, microbiology, all sorts of annual reviews, and they started one on virology. So there's a very nice webpage where you can watch videos of the founders talking about why they did this. But volume one is online open access until September 2015, so a year. And you can download.
Oh, when I read that, I thought you meant it was September 15th this year. And I thought, oh, that's too late.
I thought it was cool. Let's see if I could do it now. Maybe I'm wrong. Alan, he fixed the link.
Yes.
Yeah, it's complimentary online until September 2015.
Excellent.
So you can download this first edition. It has articles. It has one, two.
And you better download it before September 2015.
Yeah. 40 years with emerging viruses, inventing viruses in the microbiota, role of a vector in arbovirus transmission, and I wrote an article with Graham Hatful on Fire and TWiV, experiences in bringing virology to new audiences.
Oh, cool.
Cool.
So check it out. And Graham recorded a video about it. We have a listener pick. You heard one already, of H5N1. This is from...
Also the Vomiting Larry video.
Right. Yes, right.
Sure. We'll put that up again.
You can't have too much Vomiting Larry.
Then we have another one from Dara who says, hi, TWiVers, PhD student in immunology at Stanford and big TWiV fan here. I wanted to share an outreach project that I and some colleagues recently put together as an immunologist's response to the anti-vaccine movement. It's a music video called I Just Can't Wait for My Vaccine, set to I Just Can't Wait to Be King from The Lion King. It's a fun and informative explanation of a lot of commonly misunderstood vaccine-related concepts. Would love if you wanted to share. We're hoping it'll prove to be a useful educational tool. So definitely give you a TWiV bump.
Yeah, this is really good.
Nice. Fun. Oh, and while we're on the topic, I got my flu shot this week. Did you?
I got mine last week.
Oh.
Yeah.
I was in Brazil.
Okay.
But I'll get it next week.
All right.
And one thing I just wanted to mention back when you were talking about this episode being a video, if people didn't watch TWiV 300 and they only listened to it, then they didn't get the Easter egg that's in the video at the end of TWiV 300. Just something fun to check out.
Yep. Thanks so much for your consideration. Dara rhymes with Sarah. 70 degrees and sunny like yesterday and tomorrow.
That's Palo Alto. Oh, those Californians.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, that'll do it for TWiV 305. In this episode, it was brought to you by the Department of Microbiology at Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai. You want to do a graduate program in virology? Check out mssm.edu/mic. They have a December 1st deadline, so you have a little bit of time, but don't wait. If you get your application in, it gets reviewed faster before everyone else. Check it out.
Beat the rush.
This episode and all the others will be at iTunes and also at twiv.tv. And we'd love to get your questions and comments. Send them to twiv@twiv.tv. People are really into the follow-up, man.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They realize they get read if they send it within a week.
Mm-hmm. And if it's relevant to the previous topic, yeah.
Sometimes I get them Friday morning. Yeah, it's pretty cool. Alan Dove is at turbidplaque.com, also on Twitter. Thank you, Alan.
Always a pleasure.
Kathy Spindler is at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. Thank you, Kathy.
Thanks. This was a lot of fun.
And I'm Vincent Racaniello. You can find me at virology.ws. You've been listening to This Week in Virology. Thanks for joining us. We'll be back next week. Another TWiV is viral. And now you get to see the TWiV after dark. Usually we shut the recorder off.
Oh, we're still okay.
And we decide what the title's going to be.
Yeah. I was so busy setting things up, I didn't have a lot of time to brainstorm for these, but...
Rhymes with shinola is pretty cool. It's not offensive, is it?
I don't think so.
Shinola is now a company in Detroit selling bikes and
watches, I think.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah. I looked them up just recently. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Somebody bought the name.
And then we have rhymes with Ebola. We have This Week in Ebola Virus. And another one which we can't mention.
And right. Sunny with a High of Ebola.
Right.
So what do you guys think?
Either rhymes with Shinola or This Week in Ebola Virus.
Yeah, those are the two that I like.
You don't like Sunny with a High of Ebola? Is that too?
We might need another one of these or three.
Right.
Okay. So what did you say rhymes with Shinola?
Rhymes with Shinola, I think.
I like that. That's good.
Yeah.
Let's do that
Ebola,
one.
Shinola. Ebola, Shinola. Yeah.
All right. Okay. Thanks, everybody. Have a good weekend.
All right.
Okay.
You too.
Thank
See you.
You
next week.
Take care.
Bye.
Bye.